often did the Lord, the God of their fathers, send his messengers to them.
And seated us with him in the heavens in Christ Jesus.
The people were being freed from their slavery, freed from their exile, and yet as they're traveling toward the promised land, they grumble. Everyone, we gather together to celebrate the reality that our God lives among us, and we respond by living our lives with the commitment we made through baptism. So let's renew that commitment all together, nice and loud, everyone, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, peace from God our Father through the Lord Jesus be with you always. Our gracious God sent his Son into the world not to condemn us, but to save us. We take a moment to seek the Lord's healing, mercy, and forgiveness. Lord, you express your immeasurable kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, we are your handiwork, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, you draw us to the light so we may live in your truth. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Have mercy on the world, free us of all sin, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
We take a moment to pray in the quiet of our hearts. O God, rich in mercy, you so loved the world that when we were dead in our sin, you sent your only Son for our deliverance. Lifted up from the earth, he is light. He is life. Exalted upon the cross, he is truth and salvation. Raise us up with Christ and make us rich in good works, so that we may walk as children of light toward the Paschal feast of heaven. We ask this through Christ, our deliverance, our hope, who lives with you in the Holy Spirit, holy and mighty God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A proclamation from the second book of Chronicles. In those days, all the princes of Judah, the priests and the people, added infidelity to infidelity, practicing all the abominations of the nations and polluting the Lord's temple, which he had consecrated in Jerusalem. Early and often, did the Lord, the God of their fathers, send his messengers to them, for he had compassion on his people and his dwelling place. But they mocked the messengers of God, despised his warnings, and scoffed at his prophets, until the anger of the Lord against his people was so inflamed that there was no remedy. Their enemies burnt the house of God, tore down the walls of Jerusalem, set all its palaces afire, and destroyed all its precious objects. Those who escaped the sword were sent captive to Babylon, where they became servants of the kings of the Chaldeans and his sons, until the kingdom of the Persians came to power. All this was to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah. Until the land has retrieved its lost Sabbaths, during all the time it lies waste, it shall have rest while 70 years are fulfilled. Now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, the Lord inspired King Cyrus of Persia to issue this proclamation throughout his kingdom, both by word of mouth and in writing. Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth the Lord, the God of heavens, has given to me, and he has also charged me to build him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Whoever, therefore, among you belongs to any part of his people, let him go up, and may his God be with him. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
A proclamation from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, God, who is rich in mercy, because of the great love he had for us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, brought us to life with Christ. By grace you have been saved. He raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavens in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from you. It is the gift of God. It is not from works, so no one may boast. For we are his handiwork, created in Christ Jesus for the good works that God has prepared in advance, that we should live in them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Proclamation of good news according to John. May the Lord be in our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him will not be condemned, but whoever does not believe has already been condemned because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God." And this is the verdict: that the light came into the world, but people preferred darkness to light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come toward the light, so that their works might not be exposed.
But whoever lives the truth comes to the light, so that their works may be clearly seen as done in God. The Gospel of the Lord. How many in here have ever been vaccinated? Quite a few of us. I recall as a kid, my mother walking us to the public school to visit the public health nurse. This was in the 1950s when the dinosaurs were still walking the earth. And we would get our vaccination so we wouldn't catch measles or the whooping cough or mumps or chicken pox. And I think to this day, one of the vaccines can still show up on your arm with a certain, it almost looked like a little a landscape of the moon. Vaccinations, what an interesting concept that in order to be healthy and to fight off disease, you take just a little pinch of that disease to build up your immunity. Isn't that sort of a strange way to be healthy, to actually get just a tiny bit sick in order to build up your strength and your immunity to be healthy? Well, it seems like that's at the heart of what's going on with that imagery of Jesus talking about the Son of Man being lifted up, just like Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert. The people were being freed from their slavery, freed from their exile, and yet as they're traveling toward the promised land, they grumble. They forget that God is accompanying them, that God is looking out for them. They grumble, they turn from God, they're not faithful. And in all of that, God continues to remain faithful. And so in the midst of their unfaithfulness, a lot of them were bitten by serpents. And so Moses pleaded to God, God, save your people once again. And so Moses was instructed to put a bronze serpent on a pole, to raise up that pole of the bronze serpent. And anybody who looked at that pole and had been bitten by the serpent would be healed, would be restored to life. And isn't it fascinating, too, that to this day we use that symbol of the serpent on a pole to symbolize medicine, to symbolize the medical profession. To take a little bit of something that would make you sick to actually make you stronger. And so Jesus uses that imagery to talk about what's going to happen to him. Just like that serpent on the bronze pole lifted up, Jesus too will be lifted up on the pole of the cross. Jesus too will be held high. And how ironic that the most terrible way of being murdered at the time of Jesus, the worst form of capital punishment, has now become that powerful symbol of the fullness of life. Isn't it strange? If people were to come from 2,000 years ago and see the types of jewelry we wear today, that people are wearing, you know, crosses in their ears, or crosses that are pendants, they'd be horrified. That was the worst form of capital punishment 2,000 years ago. That would be like us walking around with earrings that had the electric chair on, or the needle for the injection for somebody that was going to be killed for their crimes. How ironic that the most terrible symbol of death, the time of Jesus, now has become that powerful source of the fullness of life. Jesus being lifted up on the cross draws us to him, draws us for healing, draws us for wholeness, kind of pulls out of us the sickness, the selfishness, the sin. You know, ever so often I'd get a little sore or something, or like a boil, and I'd think, well, no, what in the world can I get rid of this? It hurts, the pressure. And somebody told me about this salve that you can go to the pharmacist. It's called a drawing salve, and you put it on, and it draws out all the poison. Well, that's what looking at Christ on the cross is meant to do.
to draw out the poison we experience in our lives, to make us healthy, to make us whole, to draw out anything that is not good for us, anything that doesn't help us be the sons and daughters of God, help us be people that walk in the light. And so that very powerful imagery is presented to us during these Lenten days. We are called to come to Jesus, look upon him who has been crucified, bring to him things that hold us back from being people of light. Allow him to be like that salve that draws out of us our selfishness, our sin, our hurtful choices, all the things that keep us from being the very best version of ourselves. That's what this season of Lent is about. And so the key in order to having a successful Lent is looking upon Christ crucified and allowing him to draw us out of ourselves, free us from things that hold us back. And then in turn, we will be energized to do the works of light. St. Paul goes to great lengths in his writings to say, we don't earn God's favor by our good works. We could never do enough good works to earn God's forgiveness, to earn God's love. It's a complete gift. It's a grace. But we respond then to that gift in gratitude. We respond to God setting us free from things that hurt us, ways in which we hurt one another. Our response then is good works. And so it's kind of reversed. Sometimes we might think, I just got to get myself together and so I can make God like me, so I can earn God's forgiveness. Doesn't work that way. It's just the opposite. We need to look upon Christ crucified, allow him to draw us to himself, and then we respond with various works of light. So that's why we're busy about so many different charitable ways of reaching out to others during this Lent. I'm sure you've talked about different ways in which you can be concerned for others in your classes. As a parish at large, we have the wonderful Matthew 25 project with all the different ideas on the cross there by the baptismal font. That is our response. That is our demonstration of gratitude that the Lord frees us, the Lord saves us like a salve, draws us out, makes us whole, makes us holy and wholesome. And so we're a little bit past the midway point of Lent, and so we come together this evening to thank God that he saves us, to thank God that we have Christ crucified to look upon, to draw us into a deeper experience of God's life, God's light. And we thank God for that, and we come that we might glow ever more brightly with God's light as we continue through this Lent and bring God's good works to others. For that we give thanks, we give praise, and we come together to help one another on this journey of Lent toward the light of Easter.
On page 8 is our profession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and is dead. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body.
by God's grace, we have been saved. Aware of this great gift from God, we now offer our prayers in faith.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, may she lead us to God and guide us through tough moments. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For world leaders, may they work together to find peace. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all families, may they be happy and connected. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, may they hear our prayers to heal them. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those intentions we hold deep in our hearts, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. God of all faithfulness, root us firmly in your saving power. Hear and answer our prayer, which we voice in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. For he is Lord forever and ever.
Our presentation song will be You Make All Things New on page 27.
Pray, friends, that these are gifts, the many gifts of Lent, may all be acceptable to God, our loving Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands, the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church.
Amen. With joy, Lord, we present to you the sacrifice which brings us eternal healing. Grant in your goodness that we may celebrate this mystery with faith and offer it worthily for the salvation of all the world. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just that we should always give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you do not cease to spur us on to possess a more abundant life. Being rich in mercy, you constantly offer pardon and call on sinners to trust in your forgiveness. Never did you turn away from us, and though time and again we broke your covenant, you have bound the human family to yourself through Jesus, your Son, with a new bond of love so tight it can never be undone. Even now you set before your people a time of grace and reconciliation, and as we turn back to you in spirit, you grant us hope in Christ Jesus, a desire to be of service to all, while we entrust ourselves more fully to your Holy Spirit. And so, filled with wonder and praise, we sing your glory. Indeed, holy, O Lord, you are the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this to remember me." Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his dying and rising, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and serve you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring us to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Jerome, our Bishop, and all who serve your people. Remember our loved ones who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph, her husband, the apostles, Saint James, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may come to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him.
With the words of Jesus, we approach our God in confidence.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
We share with those around us some sign of Christ's peace. Behold the Lamb of God, who frees us from sin to become people of peace. Blessed are we called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus bring us all to life everlasting. I invite forward the ministers of communion for the homebound. We're glad you can bring the Eucharist to someone who can't be here, and so we send you with our prayers for them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Gracious God, you enlighten everyone who comes into this world. Fill our hearts with the light of your grace, that our thoughts may always be pleasing to you, and our love for others be sincere, through Christ our Lord.
These aren't Easter eggs, these are resurrection eggs. The custom of Easter began thousands of years ago. As a matter of fact, it predated Christianity. For ancient people, the symbol of new life was an egg. When the shell broke, new life came into the world. For many years, it was a custom to give eggs as a gift during the spring festival. The egg is also one of the ritual foods eaten at the Jewish feast of Passover. People today don't always understand the meaning of the symbols we use in our celebration. For Christians, the Easter egg is a symbol of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Painting Easter eggs is an especially beloved tradition in the Orthodox and Eastern Catholic churches, where the eggs are dyed red to symbolize the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross. Easter eggs are blessed by the priests at the end of the Paschal Vigil and distributed to the congregants. The hard shell of the egg represents the sealed tomb, and the cracking of the shell represents Jesus' resurrection from the dead. Historically, Christians would abstain from eating eggs and meat during Lent. Easter egg hunts and Easter rolling are two popular egg-related traditions. An egg hunt involves hiding eggs outside for children to find on Easter morning and represents the search for Christ in the tomb. Eggs are rolled as a symbolic reenactment of the rolling away of the stone from Christ's tomb. In the United States, the Easter egg roll is an annual event that is held on the White House lawn each Monday after Easter. So we're going to show you what resurrection eggs symbolize.
So the first egg inside is a piece of palm branch, which symbolizes Palm Sunday. Jesus rides into Jerusalem on a donkey a few days before his arrest, trial, death, and resurrection. The crowd uses palm branches to wave at him and cheer him, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David." At Mass, we use palms to recall Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem.
The second egg is bread, and Holy Thursday at the Last Supper, Jesus gave his disciples the Passover unleavened bread, saying, "This is my body given to you."
The third egg contains grapes, which represent Holy Thursday. Jesus shared the cup of Passover wine made from grapes. It is now a sign of a new covenant that Jesus made with us. He blessed the wine, saying, "This is my blood, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Egg number four contains praying hands. On Holy Thursday, Jesus prayed in the Garden of Olives while his friends waited. Some of them fell asleep. We traditionally are invited to stay in church after the Holy Thursday Mass to pray and think about Jesus.
The fifth egg is the silver coins. Before the Last Supper, Judas is said to have gone to the chief priests and agreed to hand over Jesus in exchange for 30 pieces of silver and have returned the money afterwards filled with remorse. The sixth egg has a piece of leather. The Roman soldiers always beat and whip their prisoners. When Jesus fell down carrying the cross, the Romans picked him up and began to beat him again. The Roman soldiers beat and whipped him according to Roman law, which had no limit.
The seventh egg is a thorn. The Roman soldiers placed a crown of thorn branches on Jesus' head, which cut and tore into his head. They did this to make fun of him for calling himself the King of the Jews.
The eighth egg contained a pair of dice. After the Roman soldiers stripped Jesus of his clothing, they threw dice to see who would get to keep his garments. Because it was too finely made to divide among them, and they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves.
The ninth egg contains nails. As part of the crucifixion, Jesus' two hands and two feet were nailed to the cross. He died out of love for us. While on the cross, he asked God to forgive those who betrayed and hurt him, saying, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
The tenth egg has a piece of white cloth. Jesus' dead body was taken from the cross, and his friends wrapped him gently in a white burial cloth and laid his body in a borrowed tomb, donated by a Pharisee named Joseph of Arimathea, who believed in him. We use white to symbolize Easter and of Jesus' rising from the dead to bring us eternal life.
The 11th egg has a stone. Jesus' tomb was sealed by a large stone. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb.
Okay, the 12th egg is empty. Even though the tomb was well guarded around the clock, Jesus' tomb was empty when the woman went to anoint his body. He won the battle over death and is with us now.
Thank you. Are we grateful? All that talk about eggs, I'm getting a little hungry now. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace to continue the journey of Lent.
Thanks be to God.
Our closing song will be "All the People Said Amen" on the extra half sheet. And afterwards, when we're done, can you keep the half sheets on your pews? Thank you.